Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Flashback 64, the chronological Nintendo podcast, I guess. We're talking about television again. We've been doing some side shows on other media and stuff from around the same time period, and we've just broken ground on television. I'm Gooey here with McKenna.
Hello.
I guess we did an episode on Star Trek. Mm-hmm. And we're going to do more because we collectively love that. But we're taking a look at what are some other, you know, what are the big 90s television touchstones. And I think the biggest one, maybe one of the biggest television shows of all time would be The Simpsons. So we're here talking about that. And I wanted to do it with my pal, who I think is the biggest Simpsons fan I know. And that Ooh. Is my buddy Vic. Hey, Vic.
Hey, Goo. That takes me back.
Yeah, for people who don't know, Vic and I think, Vic, you are the first person I ever podcasted with.
Is that true?
Yeah, I mean, I started the wrestling one, and then like a couple episodes in, you joined and were permanent, and so you're my original podcasting brother.
I was so honored when you asked me, hey, do you want to be a guest on my wrestling podcast? I was like, I made it. Yes. Here we are.
And that was like 10 years ago, I think, too, which is wild.
Was it?
It's got to be close to it, yeah. Maybe like 9 or something. I don't remember exactly when it started.
Yeah, it's got to be, I mean, yeah.
I can't remember what was going on at the time. I don't even remember.
It was definitely, I'm sure the two of you have, like, the pre-COVID and then post-COVID, like, when you think about the passage of time. I do remember we were working on the PWRV podcast, like, at least 7 years ago, because I was working at a school at the time, and I accidentally emailed several of my coworkers a link to one of the episodes. And I don't know if any of them listened to it or not, but I do. There was a time when you and I, yeah, would work on that podcast when I should have been working at that school. And that was at least 6 or 7 years ago. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. It's crazy that it's like, starting to be nostalgic about things that I did well into adulthood, you know? It's like weird, but
have the two of you done any wrestling conversations for this podcast? Have you gotten into like the realm of 90s wrestling?
So not exact. I've been watching like Nitros and Raws and stuff from the time, and just for fun, as we, because we're going chronologically, and
okay,
we've mentioned some events on the show for fun, you know, we're throwing some like bits of historical tidbits, but we haven't covered any of the wrestling games. Obviously, haven't come up yet.
Okay.
But I was thinking, this is maybe too behind the curtain type talk, but I was thinking eventually of like, you know, it'd be fun to like, I don't know, talk about bigger things, or like maybe watch Wrestling with Shadows and talk about the Screwjob and stuff like that. Could be fun,
okay,
you know?
The big, yeah. The things that defined wrestling in that time period.
Yeah. So, yeah, Vic, we've been pals now for a long time.
A long time.
I think what's cool is, like, we share, you know, we both like wrestling. We both like video games. We met through music, so I just feel like we have a ton of crossover of interests. And I mean, I guess since we got you on our Nintendo 64 podcast, do you have a background with N64?
I love the Nintendo 64 so much. I have like my original Nintendo 64 from when I was a kid, and all of my games still. One of my only regrets is that I lived in like a punk house for a few years from like the ages of like, I don't know, 18 to 23. And people would always like steal your stuff, like just like unfortunately the nature of like a sketchy punk house. But on my Nintendo 64 games, I had to write Vic on the spine of every single one. So I have them all, but they have in big black Sharpie letters, Vic, 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 Vic. So I have like all, you know, whatever 30 Nintendo 64 games. I love the Nintendo 64 a lot.
Okay, yeah. I mean, we talked about the wrestling games. Did you play those on there?
WWF WrestleMania and No Mercy and the WCW games are like still to this day, like, I just got the last time I got my Nintendo 64 out was to play those games.
Yeah,
They're
okay.
so, like, have either of you, I know you have, but have you ever played the wrestling Nintendo 64 games? Is that, like, within your wheelhouse at all?
I have not.
No, so that'll
Oh,
be,
we're gonna get there
we're gonna be
at
playing a
some
lot of them.
point.
It'll be interesting, yeah.
Soon? Do we have one coming up soon?
Yeah,
Sort of
sort of.
soon.
We're going, we do one episode like on an N64 set of games
Sure.
like a month, so we're like moving like molasses through the catalog. But it allows us, like I said, to take time and stop and like talk about other things going on at the time. So we're kind of
Sure.
right now like a 90s pop culture podcast as well, you know?
That's how that goes, yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. This actually, we can sort of connect this to our topic today because we actually just, the last game we like officially covered as of recording was Clay Fighter 63 and a third.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know that? Okay. And that features the voice
Absolutely.
talents of Dan Castellaneta, voices some characters in that game. So,
You are
Simpsons
teaching me something
crossover.
right now because I had no idea about that.
Yeah, it's got like four or five like famous voice actors doing some of those characters, and yeah, Dan Castellaneta is on there.
I genuinely had no idea. That's today I learned. That's shocking to me.
Wow, Nelly!
But yeah, of course he does the titular Homer Simpson of The Simpsons. So like I said, yeah, we're gonna talk about today. We're gonna talk about like the early years, which kind of for me actually, the range of time we're covering for seasons one and two of the show started in December 1989, and season two ended July 1991. So we're just it's almost perfect for our show because we're gonna go into the 2000s, but for a while we're gonna be a 90s show, and this show kind of like it's like the most 90s like show I think, and it kicks off the 90s. I was also born in 1990, so I feel like it was around at the start of my life, you know what I mean? Like it's just like
Okay.
for me it's like it's just like ingrained in my life a little bit. I'm not like the biggest fan in the world, but I am like you know, I just The Simpsons has always been there. But Vic, I said you're the biggest fan I know, but how do you I know you're a big fan. What's your story with The Simpsons?
So, I was going to ask the two of you first, because I think this is a very important
Okay.
like delineation. Did the two of you watch The Simpsons when you were kids? Like when you were growing up, were you allowed to watch The Simpsons?
Yeah, McKenna, you go first.
I don't know if I was allowed to or not. I didn't watch a ton of TV as a kid. I was very much a book kid. Like
Okay.
I'd, go to the library, come home with a stack of books and just be reading all the time. I watched some TV, but lots of books.
Okay, so there's no Simpsons controversy.
No.
Also, McKen, I think by the time you were like kind of age to like start watching it is after it had begun the downfall of the Simpsons. So,
And we could talk
but
about that. There is like a what they call the classic years. Yeah.
so yeah, for me, I did watch. I was not allowed to watch it at first, but I think it's a really hard thing to like police. Because it's just on, it would be on all the time. Like,
All the time.
obviously, yeah, I remember, the new episodes would come out on Sunday nights, but I primarily watched it. You'd come home from school and it would be on, like, right after that. And your parents aren't home from work, and maybe, like, the babysitter, or, like, my grandparents would be watching us, but you could get The Simpsons in. And that was the primary way I watched it, was like, by the time I was watching it, like, it was close to the end of the quote unquote golden years, but that's
Yeah.
when I was watching it then, I'm just seeing repeats of all these kind of classic episodes and stuff like that. And then after it quote unquote got bad, and when I kind of got older and not interested in watching TV as much for a while, like I kind of, unlike other people, like I didn't really even like keep up with like watching old Simpsons or, it's just like it wasn't really there for me. It was sometime after like the movie came out or something, where I was
Okay.
just like, I just, not interested at all. But I noticed in the past, like, whatever, 5 to 10 years or whatever, anytime an episode has come on or I've watched an episode from that golden years that I had not seen since I was a kid, I would find myself knowing, like, every line, like, remembering everything that happens. I couldn't, like, recall it from memory, but as I'm watching it, I'm like, I must have seen this, like, 1,000 times, you know what I mean? Because everything is just, would just come back, and so I think that speaks to at least some of how it was ingrained in me, you know?
I mean, it was, like, 1,000%, and I watched, like, so my wife is also a huge Simpsons fan, and so, like, we watched a couple other YouTube videos and stuff of just, like, remembering how ingrained it was in, like, every aspect of popular culture. Like, you know, it, like, for a cartoon, it was, like, the spokesperson for candy bars, and you would, like, I mean, there were Happy Meal toys and, like, so much stuff. It was definitely the first, like, I think, cartoon to really, like, the first, like, cartoon that wasn't, like, specifically designed to make toys. Like, it wasn't, like, He-Man, right? But in my mind, like, the first, like, it was, like, the first of its kind. And really, like, now, it's, like, there are whole, like, blocks of television and whole, like, networks kind of devoted to, like, adult cartoons. But I feel like none of those cartoons would exist without The Simpsons. Like, The Simpsons was, like, the very first, I don't know, like, not just, like, for kids cartoon, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Wow. It's definitely, it's like a, it's a sitcom, you know?
And that's, you know, not to give you a hard time, McKenna, I do think there's, like, a line in the sand. Like, when I meet someone, like, so I, The Simpsons is, like, such a huge part of my life. I'm quoting The Simpsons, like, I have a Simpsons tattoo. There's an episode in season 8, so, like, years later, so we're talking about the golden years, where Homer becomes a boxer, and so I have a tattoo of Mo Sizzlak on my leg from that episode. Like, it's a big tattoo. Like, it's, I mean, it's, like, bigger than my hand. I love The Simpsons so much, and so that's, like, for me, always, like, you know, it's not, like, hi, I'm Vic, nice to meet you, do you like The Simpsons? But I feel like it kind of naturally gets brought up. And if someone says, like, oh, no, I didn't watch The Simpsons when I was a kid, or I wasn't allowed to watch The Simpsons when I was a kid, I'm like, oh, do you live in, like, one of those weird, like, households? Like, not weird, like,
yeah,
you know, like, I don't mean to disparage, but, like, oh, like, is this, like, a super strict or a super religious or, like, a homeschooled household? Because, Gooey, to your point, like, yeah, there was, like, so much, like, outrage, like, oh, my God, I can't believe that, like, kids are allowed to watch this show. But when you watch these, like, especially these first two seasons, it did kind of make me think, like, wow, it's crazy to think that this was, like, really, like, pushing the envelope at the time.
Yeah,
right. Like, when you watch them now, I'm just like, what's the big deal? Who cares?
They're worried about, time, like, Bart being, like a miscreant or whatever.
Yeah,
it's, like, pretty tame. Like, a little
rapscallion. Yeah. He's like, oh, he's getting up to mischief.
But that is was kind of what appealed about it a little bit as a kid, you know. You're like, it was like, it did feel a little bit edgy, you know.
And that's, you know, I like I remember being a kid and, like, yeah, there's Bart and he's doing pranks and he's got the slingshot and there is, like, that Dennis the Menace kind of quality. As an adult, I can appreciate all of the, like, more, like, serious references and, like, the emotional aspect. I don't know. Okay, let me ask you this. Did either of you cry watching any of these episodes?
Yes. Did you?
Okay.
No.
Okay. So
there are some touching episodes though.
Yeah, so that's you've kind of hit on it, Vic. I you felt this way too, like, and I think it goes without saying, like, these actually most of the episodes from here aren't ones that, like, when I watch them I remember everything. I don't think they got as heavy rotation, cuz these, the first season are particular, but the second season a little bit too is kind of before The Simpsons settles into, like, what people think as, like, the really good stuff.
100%. When you asked me, like, hey, do you want to do an episode of our podcast and talk about The Simpsons? I know you and I talked about, like, hey, do we do, like, the golden season? So that's, like, for anyone who isn't familiar, like, okay, the golden seasons start around season 3. And kind of, there's some debate on, okay, is it season 8? Is it season 9? Is it season 10? But that kind of block there. Like season 1, like watching episodes from season 1, I'm like, like, this is important to, like, the foundation of the show. None of those are, like, my favorite episodes.
I can see that, but what I was thinking watching it was, yeah, sure, it's not as, like, gut busting laughed or anything, but it I thought it was like a really nice, like touching, often funny and touching like sitcom like about this family. And like the writing is real, like the jokes aren't as funny, but I think the writing and the stories were really good. And like I said, I really connected with a lot. Did you like what did you think of all the overall tone of The Simpsons? Like, have you, I guess you didn't watch it as much as a kid, but have you really watched much Simpsons at all?
Not too much. Okay. Like, I'll occasionally catch a little bit of an episode, and sometimes you put them on.
We have watched all of season eight because it did come out. It came out when the N64 was out, and I was like, let's watch it. Sure.
I guess I was surprised at some of the more, not serious, but there were some more, like, I guess, tonally serious, mature episodes.
Yeah, I think it was just like the top tier like sitcom writing, and I don't mean that as like a disparagement, but I think they just like with that format, they did a really good job of like telling these compelling stories in whatever, like 20 something minutes, you know?
So I'm the type of Simpsons nerd that's like listening to the DVD commentary. So like we have all of like the first 12 seasons on DVD, and we're like putting on the commentary, which
that sounds awesome. Yeah.
I love DVD commentary so much. And so those. Like
they have them at half price books near our house. I've seen them all. I think we're next time we go in, I'll have to snag all the, it's like all the good years. So
my very first job, out like after I graduated high school, I worked at this call center, like this like telesurvey call center, which was like a god awful job. But like if you hit these certain milestones, one of the like, I don't know, incentives would be they would give out Best Buy gift cards. And so I would get one of these Best Buy gift cards every couple of months, and I would go straight to Best Buy and I would buy like the next season of The Simpsons on DVD. So that's like awesome. I was so particular, like, again, living at this punk house, people were like, can we watch your Simpsons DVDs? And I, like, guarded these with my life. I was just like, no, you cannot fucking watch these. Like, you're going to scratch them, you're going to lose them, you're going to give them to somebody else, you're going to, like, break up weed on them or something. No, these are, like, my prized, like, I'm not a huge physical, like, I love physical media, but I never got super into DVDs, but for whatever reason, like, I have all these Simpsons DVDs, and I, like, cherish these Simpsons DVDs. And so, to your previous point, I do know like the writers, especially in those first seasons, were trying to like, yeah, they were trying to make a sitcom. And one of the charms I think of the first, like, I'd say three seasons is that like, it's still very sitcom-y. Like it's not out of place with like a Cheers, but it's like just silly enough because it's animated. They're able to do a couple of like sillier, more over the top things that really like take it to kind of the next level for me. And these seasons are not my favorite, but they do hit that sweet spot of like, okay, these are still good. If you like those like late 80s, early 90s sitcoms, I think you're going to like The Simpsons.
Yeah, I very much enjoyed it. Like, I guess like the way I had seen people talk about it before, I was like, oh, is this going to be like a slog to get through? But instead, I found myself pretty much every episode I enjoyed.
McKenna, let me ask you this. So when so I work at a school with college students, and sometimes so I have like a little like there's a character in season 8, his name is Hank Scorpio. I don't know if either of you watched the Hank Scorpio episode. Mm-hmm. One of the best episodes of all time. So I have this little Hank Scorpio like figure in my office because he's a great boss and he gives like very sage advice. And so sometimes like students will ask me about it, and they see The Simpsons as like a less funny version of Family Guy. Like sometimes students will ask me about right. it, and they'll be like, oh, what is that, like The Simpsons? And I'm like, oh yeah, do you know about The Simpsons? And they're just like, oh yeah, you know, I would like The Simpsons and Family Guy, and they kind of like lump that all together. Huh. So for you, McKenna, someone who did not watch The Simpsons, do you see like these as like similar? Do you see them in the same vein?
I definitely think of Family Guy as being a different mm-hmm. tone, different type of comedy.
Yeah. I will say that of like what in that era when Family Guy came out, and even before then, you mentioned some of like the more adult cartoons. That is what I think over time overtook my love of The Simpsons. Like, it went from like Simpsons, and then South Park came out, and then Family Guy came out. I remember it got canceled and then brought back, and like Futurama, and then eventually like all the stuff with Adult Swim that yes. really took hold. And then I kind of went with that into my adulthood, was like a lot of the more like Adult Swim shows. So that, I think that did it too, where it was like eventually it was like, and it kind of coincided with the same time period that Simpsons was like not as good or whatever. So it just sort of be like, I need the harder stuff, you know, give me this, you know.
You need the swearing and the poop jokes and the
exactly. Yeah.
The topical references, which I mean, The Simpsons, I still stand by the point that like without The Simpsons, like South Park wouldn't exist. Like a bunch of these things I don't think would exist. And I do think that a lot of these episodes are like pretty timeless. Like there are like themes and there are jokes, you know, even in these first two seasons, which are not my favorite, that like I think stand the test of time, that still make me laugh, that still like, you know, make me we watched the Lisa's Substitute episode again today, and it like had me crying, it had me like tearing up. Like, it's such a touching, moving episode. I think a timeless piece of television, like genuinely really good.
Yeah, and I think even we were noticing even early on, like that's where you start to see, like, it's weird seeing it now, and you're seeing things that you've seen a million times because they've been like a meme. Mm-hmm. Like, there's even in the first two seasons, there's like random moments where it's like, it's really weird. It almost takes you out of it. Mm-hmm. Not that it's the show's fault or anything, but you're like, oh my God, I've seen this image now so many times.
Like, out of context.
Well, that's so kind of conversely. So Amanda, my wife, and I would always talk about how there are so many things that I learned about because of The Simpsons. Like, The Simpsons would reference things, like Clockwork Orange and Cape Fear. And here's like all, you know, a streetcar named Desire. And I like even like the Planet of the Apes. There's that episode in later seasons where they do a whole like Planet of the Apes musical, and like The Simpsons was my window into so many of these things before I learned about, like, I mean, I learned about them on The Simpsons first. I think that like the episode with Ringo Starr is probably the first time I heard the name Ringo Starr. Like, yeah. I mean, my dad probably played the Beatles, but I don't think, like, if you had asked me when I was 10 who's Ringo Starr, I would have said that guy from The Simpsons.
Sure, I mean, and it's like, that makes sense, because, like, the people writing on that are putting in, like, references to things they know from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and it's funny now, we're looking back on The Simpsons almost in a similar way, but I was exactly like that. I was, like, always, like, sucking up all these references, and it's like why are you referencing, like, I would start doing these references, and it's like, why, not even from this show, but just things like that in general, and people, it's like, why are you an 8-year-old referencing like Chips or something, you know what I mean? Old cop show or whatever.
I mean, I'm positive the very first time I heard an Edgar Allan Poe story was The Simpsons. And then I would quote that episode, right? Like, not even having any context of who Edgar Allan Poe was, or like why this is supposed to be so ethereally spooky and dreadful. It was just like, yeah, this is kind of funny. There's Bart as a little crow, or as a raven. I'm sorry.
Well, good night, son.
Dad?
Yeah?
What is the mind? Is it just a system of impulses, or is it something tangible?
Relax. What is mind? No matter. What is matter? Never mind.
Also, I'll say, too, just in terms of the history of The Simpsons and stuff like that, I'm sure a lot of people know, but they, you know, The Simpsons began as, like, these shorts on the Tracy Ullman show, which is fun to think about. Like, it's kind of, now, it's become such a bigger thing than, like, you know, where it originated, but, You hadn't seen these shorts or anything before.
No.
But they were interesting. Like, they were really cool on their own. Like, They're these really good bite-size little vignettes, and they're a lot of fun. Are those on any of the like DVDs or anything? That should be on like season one, right?
On season one or season two, there's definitely like DVD extras where they have them all kind of compiled. Those are like interesting and important. I'm sure the two of you noticed like between season one and season two, they really work to like kind of norm the characters and the animation style and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
I think those are interesting, but they're not very fun for me to watch. Like even like season one is like, hey, this like has its charm. But I do like when they kind of get a little bit more uniform with everything.
Yeah, it reminds me of, I don't know if you would feel this way, but we were just talking about it in our Star Trek. We were just talking about Star Trek The Next Generation, and it isn't until like the third season where it starts like stops visually like feeling like the original series of Star Trek a little bit, and they kind of like update it. But I will say there, I always find a charm to like the less polished kind of, you know, it's not my favorite, but I do actually really like it. And I think the shorts in particular over season one, where it's like way different than what we think of the characters now, just visually and stuff. And I don't know. I love rewatching those.
And there is even like a lot of Simpsons fans like to point out like the difference, like, oh, hey, here's this episode from season one where like Waylon Smithers was black and Chief Wiggum's hair was a different color and that kind of stuff. So there is like some of that kind of like continuity error stuff that is fun.
It's cool.
And I hate to be that nerd that's just like, well, actually, his hair was this color in season one. But that like I am that level of like Simpsons
nerd. No, it's fun. I like that stuff. I also just in terms of like where it started, I think it's fun. The whole reason it was developed as a sitcom as The Simpsons was Matt Groening didn't want to adapt his comics, the Life in Hell comics that he created, because he was like, I don't want to lose like my life's work. I think it was the quote I read or something. But it's funny because now, similar to the Tracy Ullman show, this is like far engulfed and surpassed like that stuff in like pop culture memory, which I think is pretty cool.
There was a whole like documentary series on Vice about like the creation of The Simpsons, and it is kind of like, I don't know, I'm sure the two of you could speak to this on like video games too, of like, okay, somebody thought like, hey, this like Life in Hell, this is really going to be the big thing, so I'm going to hold on to this because this is going to be the huge thing. And then it actually turns out that this other thing that people were kind of treating as a bit more of a throwaway became the monolith. Right. And you know, like for every like Bubsy, right? Like, oh, this is gonna be the next thing, and like people really put all of their like money into that. Just like, yes, this is gonna be it. And so yeah, I mean, there's definitely a universe where those weird rabbit cartoons that Matt Groening drew are like the huge, gigantic cultural phenomenon.
Yeah. Did you go back and get into those? Like, do you have any of those comics or anything?
So I looked through those. You know, again, I'm like a purist. Like we've watched most seasons of The Simpsons. But there is like, there's like that classic era. And I would even say like, okay, I would include season two in there, of like, this is good and nostalgic at the same time. So I do appreciate like the context, or, you know, like, hey, this is these Matt Groening comics, this is kind of neat, but I don't think those are very good to me personally. So when I'm revisiting The Simpsons, like, again, that sweet spot is like, hey, this is nostalgic, but also like, this is still really funny and clever and like still like holds up. I don't know that those comics hold up. I don't think they stand the test of time as much as The Simpsons does.
I definitely see like why, like, so they would see these and be like, we like this guy, we should give a show, because just especially for the time, they're very like, they're like, I don't know, cutting edge, I guess is the right word, just like the tone and sense of humor, you know, it really feels like ahead of its time in terms of like what we think of as like the 90s sense of humor and stuff like that. So definitely he brought that to the Simpsons in particular too, but it's a little bit more, it's a bit more family friendly, right? Because it's like a sitcom and stuff like that. So it's more digestible for a wider audience.
Which is so interesting. So like, I was also kind of reading through some Simpsons stuff from like these first two seasons. And I was reading that the like season two of The Simpsons was running up against The Cosby Show, which like, you know, with the power of hindsight, The Cosby Show. But at the time, that was like the quintessential like family show. And then like The Simpsons was seen as so subversive and so like out there and edgy comparatively to The Cosby Show. And now if you put like any of those Simpsons episodes against like, again, any of that Adult Swim stuff or like, what's that? I never saw this movie. There was like an animated movie about like hot dogs that have sex or like food that like, it's like raunchy.
Yeah, yeah. You know what I'm talking about? I saw that actually in theaters, but I don't remember what it's called.
Food Fights or...
Was it Food Fight? The Seth Rogen and them, right? Yeah. Oh, Sausage Party.
You went and saw Sausage Party in the theater?
I don't remember what. Like, I might have, that might have been the movie past days, because I definitely was like, this is gonna suck ass. You know what I mean? I didn't know. It was just for, you know, shits and giggles, I guess. You know, I don't know.
Don't get me wrong. I know you and I both appreciate the experience of going to the theater. I like going to the theater.
I've seen some truly bad stuff in theaters, like worse than that. So it's okay. So I want to, we can talk about the show and we can talk about, I think, like iconic aspects of the show that we even see early on. But I thought probably the best thing to start with would be the opening theme, because it's like the first thing you see in the show. Well, actually, is it on the, it's not on the very first episode, I don't think.
I don't think it's on the very first episode, no.
But, nonetheless, the opening theme is, that's on its own, just like this iconic piece of cultural history. I mean, I'm sure you even are quite aware of that. And that's where, you know, in this opening segment, you get a lot of what are now, like, they're almost like events now. Like, even though the show isn't as relevant now, I'll still get occasional like things online that's like, oh, look at this crazy new couch gag that they did on The Simpsons, you know, and those still come up. So even just within this little bit of the theme itself, you get some of these like big moments, like the couch gag and the chalkboard, like the different things.
The chalkboard.
Yeah.
Did either of you ever have to write something out on a chalkboard?
I never really got in trouble like that. No. You know, like I was not like a Bart Simpson type, I would say.
I don't think I knew anyone in real life that ever had to do that. But I was always like very afraid. And now, I don't know how either of you feel about this. I've got a weird textural thing, like holding chalk in my hands is disgusting. I hate the dust, chalk dust on my hands. Yeah. And like the thought of having to write like 500 times something on the chalkboard. Ugh, absolutely. It disgusts me to think about.
Like, you don't, do they use chalk still? Like, what's the deal? I haven't been in a school in like a long time.
Remember if they had any, I think they had some chalkboards at my college, but they were mostly switching over to like whiteboards or digital screens.
Okay. Erase and smart boards. Some schools still have chalkboards. I will have to send it to you both. At the school I work at, they had like youth summer camps, and one of the kids drew like this very crude Bart Simpson. Oh my God. And I got to send it to you both. And it's like, it's again, this kid had to have been 7 years old, maybe. I think to prove the point that the show is like so ingrained in the cultural zeitgeist, he has, who knows how many times he's seen The Simpsons, but he drew this Bart and he wrote, "Eat shorts." I'm sending it to you right now so you can see it.
Please.
Because, yeah, I feel like, I mean, in terms of like an intellectual property or a recognizable...
that's a good drawing.
Like, icon. It's a pretty good drawing. That had to have been a 6 or 7 year old child who wrote this.
Wow.
While they were at the school for like STEM camp or something. But it just really made me laugh. Eat shorts. Because, like, hey, maybe you've never seen an episode of the show, but to your point, you probably know a couple of these things. You probably know the chalkboard writing scene. You probably know the couch gag. I think the person who composed the opening theme song, Danny Elfman, like performs that at festivals now. Like it's like built into his like you can go see Danny Elfman and an orchestra of people, and he's done music for tons and Spider-Man, I know, and
Yeah,
Batman and
Tim
Beetlejuice and all
Burton.
kinds of
Yeah.
yes. And so you can go see him and an orchestra perform for an hour and a half, and he plays like the Simpsons theme song as like part of his concerts.
Men in Black. I
Yeah,
just
and
keep
people go
throwing
crazy
out
for
random Danny Elfman
it.
things.
I mean, so now I know if they show the long version, so there's like the short version where it just starts with like Homer about to get hit by the car and then they get on the couch ride, but there's the long version where it goes through like the whole town. And when I was a kid, I always thought that was like a rare treat. Now I know it's because the actual episode is like shorter, so they have to kind of do that to pad out the episode. But when I was a kid, there was a rumor that when Marge scans Maggie on the grocery store conveyor belt, like the price register or the cash register like flashes, and there was always this rumor that there was like secret codes on there, and if you paused it at just the right time, you'd get these secret codes.
Did you ever get the code?
So I think it's actually like the episode number. I
Oh,
think that's what it
okay.
actually is. Like, yeah, all the episodes are like numbered really weirdly. And so I think that's what it actually is.
Okay.
Although there is a clip show episode where they joke that it actually says NRA forever. But that's just a random little trivia fact. I don't think it actually says NRA forever.
Yeah, I mean, I love just the opening animations for everything in general, but yeah, you get the chalkboard of him writing like various punishments that, and it's always fun to imagine that situation. But then the couch gag, of course, has become like an event. But in the first two seasons, they're pretty tame at like at the time, they're probably very novel. But even like when you look at them compared to like season three and then even four, that's where they get really outrageous. Whereas like, did you have any favorites, McKenna? Any favorite couch gags?
Yeah, I was like rewatching some earlier, and I think I really like the there's one where it's simple, but it's just like Maggie goes flying out of from the couch, and then she just lands on Marge's lap, and they're all nice and
It's
seated
cute.
comfortably. Yeah.
You have a favorite couch gag in these early ones, Vic? Did any stand out to
Ooh,
you?
I don't know. See, I'm trying to think. They all kind of get shuffled up in my brain. There's a later one where they do like a huge chorus line, and there's like elephants
Oh,
balancing in the background. That's like
yeah.
always one of my favorite ones. See, so I'm thinking about this, and I don't know. The chalkboard writing and the couch gags are like nice. They never make me laugh usually.
Yeah.
But it's also like, oh, what's he writing? What's the couch gag? Like it's one of those things that like I'm never like, oh my God, this is so funny. But it's
Yeah,
also like in that sweet spot of like I still got to see what it is. I got to see which one it
yeah.
is. The one where they ride the couch like the atomic bomb. I'm trying to think of other good ones. The one when like Bart is like the fuzzy TV static and he gets hit a couple times.
Oh, sure.
I don't know about. Do you have a favorite
Yeah.
one, Goop?
It's I'm having a hard time remembering anything beyond like what because we've watched a bunch recently, and like I said, a lot of season one and two are just like they all run to the couch and it falls over, or it's like the season one and two ones in particular are like they remind me of like how I feel how you said about the chalk gag, where it's like it's just kind of like cute and like oh huh, that's funny, but not like gut busting laugh out loud funny or anything. They're just like
Yes,
they're
yes.
these cute little gags, little sight gags that are fun.
Like the I think it's the first chalkboard where it's just I will not waste chalk, and
Yeah.
I just think it's funny imagining a teacher being like, I want you to write, I will not waste chalk in chalk.
It gives you like a window into like what type of mischief Bart can get up to, like that he would drive a teacher to do even just that.
Yeah.
You know what, McKenna, you're right. I have to retract my statement, because you saying that, that is funny. So, man, now you have me rethinking my whole stance on these, because that is a good joke. About as good of a joke as you could possibly get with just somebody writing on a chalkboard.
If this is the father,
here, monkey, 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 monkey.
And this is the mother.
Get your hand out of that cookie jar.
Whoa, I'm scared.
Imagine what the kids must be like.
Eat my shorts. Pardon?
Sunday at 8:30 on Fox 5.
We're not gonna talk about every episode, obviously, but I did want to point out the show kind of starts off like with, it's sort of unique in that it starts off with the Christmas special, the Simpsons roasting on an open fire, and it has exactly what we're talking about. Like, it's a very, like, it's more of like slice of life. It does have a storyline, but it's very slice of life, and it is very sweet, I think, and very tender. And so I think it's kind of a good establishing like episode for the show, even though I don't think it was intended to be the first one.
Mm-hmm. It's definitely not intended to be the first one, but it like aired right around Christmas time, I think. I do think it had like, it does a good job of like setting the scene, which I would say like the first and second season do a really good job of like setting the foundation. And watching some of those first episodes, it actually kind of reminded me a little bit of Roseanne. Did either of you ever watch Roseanne?
I did, yeah.
It has kind of that similar like working class family kind of feel to it.
It gets compared to that a lot, or even Married with Children as being like, I think that was part of what appealed about the show, like, and you mentioned compared to something like the Cosby Show, where they're very like, they're less flawed, you know what I mean? Like they have their struggles and they have their drama and stuff like that, but in something like the Simpsons you really see them like in a portrayed more like realistic way, you know what I mean? In like a way that I think a lot of people at that time related to a lot more.
And it does, I think you're right that I'm almost positive that The Simpsons is like created directly as a result of the success of Married with Children. Like that Fox was looking for something in that same vein. But I think you hit the nail on the head. Something that I think myself and a lot of people like about The Simpsons is that even though it's a cartoon, it is like, it feels a little bit more like, hey, these are real characters with flaws, but it still has that nice, like, okay, for the most part, things do get wrapped up at the end of the episode. So it's like a step in that direction of like, hey, even though these are cartoon characters, it's like a little bit more of a direct peer into like a real family. But the animated aspect of it allows it to be like silly or zany, I guess. But then also, okay, everything kind of works out in the end still too.
Right. That's even the thing with like sort of, it's like with the Bart sort of stuff, they were worried about the outrage over Bart. It's like in most of the episodes, like especially ones about him, it ends up being like a morality tale, you know, and it's him learning a lesson or something like that, but like even that's too edgy. Like these like very like buttoned up like morality tales, like the kid's too rambunctious for certain families, I guess, you know.
Something else I do like about season one is that it does, so I had forgotten that the episode where Marge meets Jacques the bowler is in season one.
Yes.
And I you know, like, okay, the stereotype is that Homer is constantly the one like getting himself in these situations, and it is Homer's fault. Like Homer is still like the jerk in this episode, but I had forgotten that, like, okay, even in this first season, like, they put this kind of like unique situation on Marge. Like, I feel like in a lot of the sitcoms, it's like there's one character who's really like the flawed character, and not that Marge is flawed, like, she, you know, it all works out, but just that
But
she could find herself in that like precarious situation is still like interesting TV, still captivating to me.
Yeah, it's like Marge, like the rest of them, isn't perfect. Like, they all have their own like struggles and things like that. And yeah, I think that's a standout episode. Life on the Fast Lane, I believe that one is.
Yes.
I'll say a couple ones that were iconic or like stood out to me, and everyone can kind of throw in ones, but there was I think it was the last episode, was Krusty gets busted, moaning Lisa with the saxophone and Bleeding Gums Murphy. And I also have, for Bart, I think he had some good, the Telltale Head and Bart the General. I like that one because both of them introduce kind of like who you think of as like Nelson and those other bully kids. Like, I like those characters. So those were kind of like, for me, I think the biggest standout episodes. Did you guys like either those episodes or like what stood out to you in the first season? What stands out to you?
I think Life on the Fast Lane and Moaning Lisa, definitely. I feel like I really like the Marge and Lisa episodes.
Yeah.
I like the other ones too, but
are those your favorite characters?
I think so. I really like Lisa. Maybe mm-hmm. it's like a middle child kinship thing.
I think a lot of people can identify with like Lisa for sure. Like, I definitely wasn't the Bart type. I think, like, I guess if I was looking at the kids of like ones I would like see myself in more, it would be Lisa, but not full. Like, I don't know. I'm probably more of a Milhouse or something. but those are your favorites, you'd say?
Yeah.
Okay, how about you, Vic? Like, favorite, ooh, I guess favorite episode, standout episodes and maybe characters and stuff like that.
So I was just going to say, so yeah, we'll talk about episodes, but then I have to ask you about favorite characters from both seasons, because I feel like any real Simpsons fan, that's like always the conversation of who's your favorite character, who's your favorite Simpson, and then who's your favorite like additional character.
Your side character, yeah.
Your B-level, your C-level character. Krusty Gets Busted is good because it introduces Sideshow Bob. And Sideshow Bob is like one of my favorite characters.
He's got to be one of the best. I love Kelsey Grammer just in general. Yeah. He also shows up in Star Trek once, and so he's a legend for that to me. But obviously, Frasier.
He shows up in an episode of Star Trek?
Yeah.
What does he do in Star Trek?
Do you want to know? Is it going to derail the episode too much?
I mean,
appreciate it. Okay. So it's very quick. Please. Basically, there's an episode, they're caught in a time loop and they keep colliding with something. And then they go through all the stuff and they figure out how to do it and get out of the time loop. And they find that they are colliding with a ship from like decades from the past that went through like a wormhole, right? They find a way to avoid it at the end of the episode. And they're like, this is fucked up. Like, this ship has come from the past and now they exist in the future and they can't go back. And they're like, well, we better call the ship and let them know. It's like another Starfleet ship. And they get on the horn with them, and the captain is Kelsey Grammer. And they tell him what happens, and he's like, oh, shit. And then, like, that's the end of the episode. It's crazy that he did this. Like, he's in it for, like, 1 minute, and at the end of the episode. And so he's always a legend to me for doing that. I think he was a Star Trek fan or something like that, but anyway.
Okay. Okay.
Him as Sideshow Bob. I had no idea. Love Sideshow Bob for sure.
there are, I'm thinking about season one episodes, and there are so many like status quo episodes where they like introduce something that impacts the remainder of the series.
Sure.
That Simpsons Roasting on an Open Fire episode where they get Santa's Little Helper. Stays for the rest of the series.
And I love the episodes with Santa's Little Helper, like dog based eps are like always sweet to me.
They're great. They're great. We just watched the episode where Santa's Little Helper has puppies. Is it 21 and a half greyhounds? Santa's Little Helper doesn't have the puppies. Santa's Little Helper gets another dog pregnant, and that dog Santa's Little Helper, I think, is a male dog. Mm-hmm. Male dog gets a female dog pregnant. That dog has a lot of puppies. And then Mr. Burns steals the puppy. You'll say it's a phenomenal episode. There's a really good song in there, See My Vest. It's one of the best episodes.
Classic.
But if it wasn't for that very first episode, there wouldn't be a Santa's Little Helper. I have a very vivid memory of seeing the episode where Homer goes to the bachelor party, Homer's Night Out.
Yes. Yeah.
I have such a vivid memory of seeing that episode on TV. And so that's like up there for me as just like a, that episode is okay. It's not my favorite. Mm-hmm. But just in terms of like memories of like, wow, I can't believe that this is on TV and I'm like, I'm watching this.
sure.
So that's got to be up there for me too.
You're okay. Did you, your favorite, who's your favorite Simpson of the family?
I mean, so I would agree that I'm probably most like Lisa, but I don't, and it feels like cheating to say Homer, but I think Homer best, like Homer is the best Simpson. Like he's, I mean, because he gets the most screen time, he has like the, this is not the same, but like, he almost has that like anti-hero presentation, like a Tony Soprano or like a Don Draper, in that like Homer is like a jerk. He's objectively not always a good dad. But since see the story from his perspective so often, you can't help but like care for him. Like in season two, like Lisa's substitute, like even though Homer is a jerk almost the entire episode, at the end, you can't help but like love Homer a little bit, right? It like gets a little touching. And so I feel like it's cheating because most of the episodes are from Homer's perspective. But Homer is probably my favorite Simpson.
Right. I mean, you get the idea that all the, like there are, especially with him, there's all these issues, but, like, that they all, like, love and care about each other. And I find, like, you mentioned your favorite characters and Homer. And, like, for me, like, a lot of what I like is just, like, they'll do episodes where it's, like, from the perspective of, like, Homer and Marge's relationship or Homer and Lisa or Lisa and Bart, you know, and I always like that where they, like, really focus in, like, the specific dynamics of the characters on the show. My favorite Simpson is Maggie. I love Maggie.
She's
cute. I don't know. It's like it's like a random, like there's just all these little moments where like something's happening and like they take the time to like have something happening with Maggie, mm-hmm. or just even like she just falls down randomly, you know. It's always very like, it always, like, that gets me now. I don't think I would have cared for that as much when I was younger, but now I'm just like, aw, Maggie. Mm-hmm. I like when, like, the plot, like, when they're, like, not when they focus around her, but, like, when, like, the kids are getting up to something and, like, Maggie is involved, even though she doesn't really have much, like, agency, but she seems like she wants to be there and is doing what they want to do. You know, I find that very relatable, like, I mean, I was the oldest kid, but I just find it relatable of, like, the kid just kind of emulating their older siblings, you know? I think it's very sweet.
Yeah. There is a later episode that, so, like, I agree with all of that. And it is, like, they've done a couple of, like, Maggie-centric episodes. There's an episode in season 6, I think, that I would recommend. It's, like, the episode is all about, like, Maggie being born. It's called And Maggie Makes 3. And it does a really good job of like, putting on just enough of that, like sanguine, like sweet, like it's a very touching episode. And they're like looking through a photo album and they're like, hey, why aren't there any pictures of Maggie? And you learn that like Homer actually has all of the pictures of Maggie up in his like work area. It's a very touching episode.
You mentioned, it's come up a few times, Lisa's substitute. So maybe let's talk about season 2 a little bit.
Season 2.
That's where I think one of the highlights of the show, something again that still occasionally makes its way into the wider public consciousness. Season 2 introduces the Treehouse of Horror, which becomes like every season they do Halloween things. And that's my favorite thing in the show, like the favorite episodes they do. You've seen a couple of them, right? Like I figured you would really like those because you like sort of like spooky Halloween stuff. But it introduces it here. And you mentioned, Vic, the Raven episode. That's maybe my favorite. I know Simpsons sometimes like relies, it'll sometimes like get a lot out of having a guest star, and sometimes like it's like kind of lazy or cheap, like to just have the guest star on and like they're doing their thing. But having like the James Earl Jones, like it's not only was like the first time you heard Edgar Allan Poe when you were younger was like yes, it was The Simpsons, but you were also, it was also this like really beautifully read version by James Earl Jones. So I think that's incredible. Like, I think it's one of the best like performances on the whole show.
I mean, it is, I think you could make a good argument that like, The Simpsons is art. When I was a freshman in college, I took a public speaking class and I had to debate a point, and my point was that The Simpsons was the best television show of all time for its like impact on art and culture. And so something like that is like a very good argument that like, hey, this is like an adaptive piece of art. It's beautifully animated. Watching the DVD commentary, they talk a lot about like the art of animation and doing some of that stuff, which is not something I know a ton about. Or even really appreciate it until I would hear them be like, oh my gosh, like the way they had to direct this shot and the way they had to design this and like animate it. And there are some really like season two is when it starts to get into some of that stuff. I did also in that debate speech learn that the word dough is now in the Webster's dictionary. And so I feel like that in and of itself is like enough to prove its cultural merit and context. But yeah, that
big time.
The Raven is phenomenal. I watched it in high school several times and definitely got an A on like questions about Edgar Allan Poe's The Raven in some English classes, specifically because of this episode.
We've actually seen Edgar Allan Poe's grave together.
Yeah.
Not to brag, but yeah.
Where is he buried?
It's in Baltimore.
Oh. Was it a spooky grave? Is it a...
Kind of. The circumstances of his death are very spooky, but we don't have time to get into that.
I didn't realize. I don't know how he died.
Might have.
Did Kelsey Grammer show up?
No, he might have been having to do with election fraud, but we don't know for sure. No one knows. But let's stop the steal is what I say. Okay. Also in that episode, you've got like a good like haunted house one. It's kind of like a fun Simpsons take on it. Very fun. We also get you introduce the aliens of Kang and Kodos, who we love. And
Kodos.
Both names come from characters from Star Trek the original series. So again, there's you can see another good reference. You like the aliens?
Yeah. I like the part where because Lisa finds the book. And she's like, they're going to eat us. And they kept like uncovering new parts of the title.
That's a great gag.
That is like a very like The Simpsons gag. Like,
yes.
Yeah.
In a bunch of the DVD commentary, they referred to those as screw the audience jokes, where they're like specifically like subverting your expectations. Like you think the joke is this. And then we're actually going to go the exact opposite way, which is not necessarily like unique. Like the Simpsons weren't the first people to do that, but I feel like that in and of itself is a good, like, you think it's going to go this way, and then it goes this way, and then it goes this way, and then it goes this way. Just like subverting expectations. Season two is when they start to do a good amount of that.
Yeah, other standout eps I thought for me was Bart gets an F. I thought it was a good episode. It's like, of that one made me feel bad, like kind of sad.
That episode is so the end when Bart's crying.
Yes. Oh God.
Is genuinely like heart wrenching to me. Like, I have felt that way. Like that's like a very real like.
Well,
what a good job that this animated series could capture the feeling of like genuinely working hard and like trying your best only to come up short. Like for an animated cartoon, it does such a good job of capturing the like that feeling. It makes me cry every time.
Yeah, I would get serious for a second. Because it really took me back like prime time when I was watching The Simpsons in particular. And I think a good way I could have gotten away with it a lot was like around that age, or it was more like when I was in sixth grade, I think it was, my parents got divorced. And I didn't really think it at the time, but like that did have a big effect on me. And I had a hard time then like moving. I had to move schools, and then I had to move back, and it was tough. And I actually did fail the sixth grade, and I had to do it again. And so watching that, I hadn't seen, or I probably saw that episode when I was younger. I didn't remember it, but watching it, and like obviously it takes me back to that age. But then like seeing the way, like how he reacted and stuff, like it did put me in. Like I remember when that happened. Like when I found out I was gonna have to redo the grade and everything, it felt like the end of the world. You know what I mean? Like
yeah,
it was devastating. So like it really hit me pretty hard watching it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like that's I'm sorry that you had to
well, it's okay
experience
now,
but... that. But everything worked out just like an episode of The Simpsons. But yeah, like what a real like what a real feeling. And to be conveyed through a cartoon is like genuinely like amazing to me.
It made me think of how much I like came to hate the grading system that schools have now. You know, I was like a straight A student, and you know, I always wanted to get the A's, and I think it took me a long time to realize that failing things was a good thing. I think maybe not until college where I realized like it was when I messed up stuff that I was learning more. Mm-hmm. And that like just like, you know, the grading system, I think, really fails students on both ends, on both sides of things, where, you know, you're focused on getting the grade and not on helping the student.
Yeah.
And Bart is just like so earnest and committed in this. And yeah. It's like it's sad.
It also made me think of one of my friends in high school who he always did really bad in school, and I think I've mentioned him on the show before. He was kind of a troublemaker, and he was like my best friend for a couple of like my high school years. And I always even felt like at the time like that like he was like a smart guy, but like the way school worked like didn't work for him. And it just, you know, it makes me think of that, you know, like, I don't know.
And that's, I mean, that's, the show doesn't always, I think, represent this or intend to represent this, but like, yeah. Hey, Bart's kind of an asshole. But like, you know, he's like, just because he doesn't do well in school, like they still show him as being intelligent, right? I think the show does do a good job of like showing like the, I don't know, the spectrum of like what it could mean to be a good person, right? Like whether that's intelligence or whether that's like being a caring individual. And McKenna, to your point, I mean, right, the charm of a lot of like sitcoms or 30-minute like TV shows from this time period, but especially The Simpsons, is like, hey, people make mistakes and then they learn. Right. And that's like, hey, it does kind of like there is like watching a bunch of these old Simpsons episodes. I was recently going through like kind of a weird depressive period, and I was like, you know, being a little too hard on myself. And something that's comforting is like, you know what? Yeah, people make mistakes and they learn. And yeah, it works out in the 22 minutes or whatever. But it is like I was internalizing that as like a, hey, people can make mistakes, but that's not the end of the world. And you can get an F on a paper, but that's not the end of the world. And you can get caught shoplifting from the try and save, but that's not the end of the world. There's a later episode where Bart gets caught shoplifting, also very sad. And so, you know, like, hey, as long as you're learning and growing, and like Homer Simpson is a good example of that, because usually in the span of any episode, he makes a mistake. But for the most part, he learns, he grows, he tries to right his wrong.
I think in terms of episodes, like, I guess ones that are a little bit more fun, don't make you cry as much, but standout episodes as well would be, I think, Itchy and Scratchy and Marge was a big one, just because I really like, this is another case of, like, where the writers are getting to kind of do a thing they love, but, like, in The Simpsons, and I feel like I actually really like the Itchy and Scratchy cartoons being the sort of, like, you know, Chuck Jones, like, or like Tom and Jerry inspired humor, but like brought to like a higher degree of like violence and stuff like that. They're actually like really good cartoons on their own, like very funny. But then also like that storyline about Marge reacting to it. I mean, especially on a show that got that sort of reaction, it was a very good episode idea.
So I think that episode is the start of like some of the meta episodes. And this would like continue throughout like the series for the next however many episodes where like, yeah, there is some meta commentary because at the time there were parental groups that were protesting The Simpsons. And again, as crazy as that seems, because like watching these episodes, like, I don't know. There are a few things in any of these episodes where I think, yeesh, I can't believe they did that. But at the time, it was like, oh my God, like there was a lot of pearl clutching and a lot of like, this is ruining the fabric of America and yada, yada, yada. So there is even some like meta commentary there that I think is really funny.
Yeah, I like that it kind of calls back. It's like a continuation almost of the Bart Daredevil storyline. There's, oh, yes. There's like a part where Marge is like, oh, I didn't realize TV could have such an influence on kids. Yeah. They're like going through the hospital, seeing kids who have tried to emulate things that they've seen and gotten injured. And then we have a whole episode,
including wrestling,
where Marge is. Yeah, there's a wrestling one.
You that know. Was a big outrage in the 90s. Was like kids doing moves to each other. You know, like yeah,
yeah.
Which. Yeah, I don't know if I did learn several words from The Simpsons that I would try and say in casual conversation. I think I learned the word anarchy from The Simpsons, and I was definitely like in the second or third grade, like shouting anarchy in gym class, not really having any context of like what that means.
I think it was South Park had a bigger impact on me getting in trouble. Like I would say like bastard was the word I learned from. You know, oh my God, you killed Kenny or whatever.
I mean, there had to have been, and because I was not watching The Simpsons like when it was on. I was only in 1991. I was 3. I don't really remember starting to watch The Simpsons until like 1995, probably when I was like 7 or 8. And I do remember it shifted to Sundays, like sometime like season 5 or season 6. Before that, it was on weeknights, and when it was on Sundays, I would watch it religiously every single Sunday. It would be The Simpsons, then it would be something else, and then it would be The X-Files, and my family would watch The X-Files together, too.
I love Sundays.
But there was probably, at that time, like when this, like, there was probably a lot of kids who were saying, eat my shorts, and that was just like, great heavens, I can't believe, like, there were, I'm sure... there were a lot of shocked teachers in 1991. They were just, I can't believe you would say that to me. How dare you?
Can I tell you, I guess I have kind of a very basic favorite side character or like non-Simpsons family character.
Okay.
But it's, I think, Mr. Burns. I love Mr. Burns. Season 2, it has a lot of great Mr. Burns episodes. Like you have the one where he hits Bart with his car. You've got the one where Marge has to paint him. And you've got two cars in every garage and 3 eyes on every fish where he has to eat dinner with them.
Yes.
And this is not something I remembered as well, but I'm sure you know this, and it's like probably a very iconic bit in The Simpsons. But I love in every episode, he sees Homer doing something and he has to ask who he is. And that is like my favorite reoccurring joke in what we've watched. Like it always makes me laugh out loud where he's like, who is that? And Smithers says like, oh, that's Homer Simpson, sir. And he always goes, who? And it's like, you've like eaten dinner with them, you've gone to court against him, like you can't remember this guy. And yeah, he's so funny.
It is one of the like most enduring Simpsons jokes. And there is actually, so not to spoil this for you, at some point you will get to an episode where Mr. Burns is shot.
Oh yeah.
And it's
iconic.
it's an iconic episode, and it's a huge whodunit. They end on a cliffhanger, and the catalyst for Homer's motivation is that even then, years later, Mr. Burns does not know who he is. He cannot remember his name. And so there's a lot of speculation on whether or not Homer shot Mr. Burns because Mr. Burns couldn't remember his name. Any other favorite side characters?
That's who I was going to say.
Mr. Burns, yeah.
I like their multiple times where they're just... Homer is hoping to get some money out of Mr. Burns, either, you know, by suing him or as a thank you for his son donating blood.
Yes.
The double O negative blood.
Yeah, you do. I think that relationship's relatable, of just like the boss who does not pay you any mind, brought to an extreme.
The first couple of seasons do portray The Simpsons like a lot more working class and a lot more like kind of struggling with money. As the show progresses, they don't like become rich, but that like working class kind of like, you know, stay-at-home mom, single income family, that dynamic does kind of get pushed by the wayside. So it is like kind of, again, interesting to just like see them talk about that sort of stuff in these episodes. Again, a very real thing that lots of families deal with.
Some other quick side characters who are worth like mentioning. There's obviously way too many to talk about all of them, but just one that I was thinking about, reoccurring bits that are iconic. You've got I Love Mo and like them calling and pranking Mo's bar. You know, it's is there an alcoholic here? Classic stuff. Trying to think who else. You have obviously the Chief Wiggum.
Yep.
Flanders, how can you not talk about Flanders? Obviously iconic. God, yeah, there's just too, like, that's one thing that's like a strength of the show, is that it has like, even though it's like a cast of like under 10 people like doing a lot of these voices, is like the character, like there's so many characters that have such unique portrayals and voices, and obviously sometimes you can tell like that's the same person or whatever, but it does have a deep roster of iconic characters.
There is something to be said. I don't know that I ever appreciated like the art of voice acting until I like really started digging into The Simpsons. Dan Castellaneta does like so many different voices. I mean, a bunch of Hank Azaria does a bunch, like the heavy hitters of the voice cast. Like that is like really an art. Like those people are like master tradespeople of their craft. Henry Shear, like some of those people who just do like, yeah,
mm-hmm.
10 different characters. Like Henry Shear, I think, does the voice of Mr. Burns and of Ned Flanders and of Principal Skinner and of like Smithers and wow, all of these characters sound incredibly different. I'm not sure how you do that. That's just a genuine like talent and skill. And I'm glad that they found you to do that.
Yeah, I think an MVP voice actor who's not part of the main cast, but I think at least by season two is in a handful of episodes, but you got to give it up to Phil Hartman, who does so many.
I was hoping
you were
going to say Phil Hartman. I think Lionel Hutz appears in season two, right?
The lawyer guy, right?
Yes.
Yeah. That's when Bart gets hit, right, by Burns, or am I thinking of a different episode?
No, that's that episode.
The ambulance chaser.
Yes. Yeah. I don't know if he has a name or not yet, but like, yeah, Lionel Hutz and Troy McClure are probably the two most iconic Phil Hartman characters on the show. And both of them are like top tier. They're both phenomenal.
And then also the show, like we've talked about some already, but like this, they do start like having these really standout guest, like celebrity, like sometimes playing them, not yet, but they'll play themselves later, like cameos. But here you just have celebrity guest appearances. Like you mentioned Lisa's substitute, you've got Dustin Hoffman, or when Homer's brother is Danny DeVito. Yeah. A lot of cool ones. Like those are, I actually almost prefer that, because those are just like, they give really good performances and it's not like just a bit that it's them, you know?
I also like that more. Like, that's a little bit more fun to me. And when I was a kid, I didn't know who Dustin Hoffman was when I was a kid. I was just, who's this guy? And so it's kind of fun. I don't know if you saw, bringing this whole thing back to Star Trek, George Takei does the voice of Akira at the sushi restaurant. Akira. I don't know that he voices Akira forever. But yeah, at the very least in that season two episode where Homer eats the blowfish, that's George Takei.
And we'll have, I mean, Leonard Nimoy is so, so iconic in the show, but we're not there yet. So, any other thoughts on season two? Sorry, Vic, go ahead.
I like, again, this is like, I think you could still appreciate like what I would consider the best seasons of The Simpsons without watching this. But this does really like set the foundation for so many of these characters and their archetypes. And like, I think this does a really good job of like setting the stage for what would be like the best episodes of The Simpsons. This is like a Super Mario Brothers 2. Right, like it's not the best.
We just covered that as well, actually.
But it has its charms. Like there's plenty. The Herb Powell, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou episode, really good. The Lisa's Substitute, the Three Men in a Comic Book episode where they get comic where they guy. Buy the radioactive man one. Yes, the first appearance of Comic Book Guy, I think. And so like all of that stuff becomes like so. You don't even think about it in later seasons. Like there's Comic Book Guy, and The Simpsons does a good job of like, we don't need to, you maybe met him in season two, and they just kind of continue to build on that. You might not see him until season four again, and so you don't necessarily need to see all these episodes, but having seen them, I think makes the show that much more of a rich, enjoyable experience, and I think is why so many people who love The Simpsons get like really, really nerdy about it, because you could just kind of casually watch them, or you could watch every episode from every season with the DVD commentary and really like immerse yourself in it. You know, you were talking about like the ensemble cast, not unlike a Game of Thrones or a Lord of the Rings. Like there are so many characters, and if you wanted to, you could really, really dive into the lore, and a lot of that lore starts in season two.
There would be like a Silmarillion for The Simpsons. The Simmarillion. Simpsmarillion. You have any other season two, just in general, standout things, McKenna?
I was just looking at episode titles and noticing, you know, fun titles. And I noticed that Bart gets an F, but then there's Bart's dog gets an F.
Yes.
Yep.
Some of the ones we read even are like very funny titles, clever, like references to things, like, yeah, they're good with the titles for sure.
We are going to keep on trying to strengthen the American family, to make American families a lot more like the Waltons and a lot less like the Simpsons.
So yeah, we've already hit upon how it was a phenomenon, but I want to talk real quick just at the end here. Thanks. A couple things from the time that really speak to like how big it was. We already talked a lot about like the Bart Simpson outrage, or like even just Bart mania. You know, there was all the, did you have any of the t-shirts when you were a kid? I did have a Don't Have a Cow Man shirt at point.
Yes. I definitely had several like Simpsons t-shirts. And in fact, I didn't learn that this was a thing until later in life, but even like the bootleg Bart, are either of you familiar with that?
The bootleg Bart, yeah, like a lot of like Desert Storm, like Bart saying like we're gonna kick Saddam's ass or whatever, you know.
Yes. So I think it's fair to say that like if you grew up in that early 90s period, like you could have gotten licensed stuff, but you probably got some bootleg stuff too. But earlier this year, I had the opportunity to go to Italy. And we went to Pisa, the city of Pisa, and there were several vendors there selling bootleg Bart shirts in 2024. And I was so like, sick. I have to get one of these. And so it was like Bart, like, running and trying to push the Leaning Tower of Pisa uprights. And I was like, I can't believe that people are still making these. It's 2024. And again, that just speaks to the staying power of The Simpsons. I don't think The Simpsons has been good in a really long time, but I 1,000% bought this bootleg, very poorly made, iron-on graphic t-shirt of bootleg Bart's. I had to get it.
Yeah. Bart, like, Well, also he was used by George Bush. I don't know if you remember that, but he called him out. I think actually both George and is it Barbara, right, was his wife, or is that George? I don't know.
Who are, yes.
The first lady of George H.W. Bush. They both didn't like The Simpsons. They said it was like dumb or whatever. But there was a famous speech that George Bush gave that says, America needs to be a lot more like the Waltons and less like The Simpsons. And that was like a big thing, which kind of showed just how like a kind of out of touch he was at the time. But he obviously ended up appearing in the show later, so you know, I guess there's water under the bridge. But
so that's so funny that you say that, because again, talking earlier about things that we learned from The Simpsons first, I know that George H.W. Bush's wife's name is Barbara.
Okay, Barbara.
Or Bar, because of an episode later in the series where the George Bush family moves across the street from The Simpsons.
Yes.
George W. Bush in that, or George H.W. Bush, is not voiced by himself in that episode, but I learned a lot about...
Oh, for some reason I thought he was.
Like, I learned a lot about presidents from that episode. I learned a lot about Supreme Court justices from The Simpsons. So I don't think I had any idea that there was a real-life situation where George H.W. Bush was referencing The Simpsons, but I do know that the first lady in 1990 was Barbara Bush, specifically because of an episode of The Simpsons.
Okay, it's educational. You know, I also had read that they had gone, like, when one of the first or second season episodes re-aired, they changed the chalk gag to Bart writing, it's spelled potato, not potato, which is based on, actually, your mom, McKenna, was just talking about this, how the vice president, Dan Quayle, visiting a children's classroom, told a kid they spelled the word potato wrong when they actually had spelled it right. And he became like a laughing stock, you know, like, look at this boat. Both of these stories for the president and vice president show like what bozos they were and like how out of touch they were and like whatever, you know. So The Simpsons, you know. Maybe you could say that's why you didn't get a second term. So some might say it was the economy, but I say it's The Simpsons. yeah, the shirts, you talked about the shirts, the merchandising in general is just crazy. And like, I think Groening had a similar thing to like George Lucas, where he had the merchandising, right? So this is very good for him. But just some other big things I wanted to talk about just in terms of like wider media was... And we listened to it, and this was big for me as a kid, but they put out an album, The Simpsons Sing the Blues album.
Yo, hey, what's happening, dude? I'm a guy with a rep for being rude, terrorizing people wherever I go. It's not intentional, just keeping the flow.
Did you listen to this, Vic, when you were younger?
So I remember so vividly seeing it at the Kmart. But my mom would like refuse to get it for us.
Okay.
I want to say, man, was it a CD? It was a CD, because we didn't start getting CDs until like way later. But I can like picture the album cover so vividly with their faces on it. There were a bunch of like songs in the key of Springfield. I remember like what a huge media juggernaut this came to be, because there, I don't know, I think I've listened to those once or twice. There's no way that they're good, right? Like, there's no way that, like, well, no,
let's ask someone who just heard it for the first time. What do you think?
Okay, McKenna? Okay.
I think they're pretty fun.
No, it rocked. Yeah. It rocked.
it's definitely fun to hear them, like, their voices.
It's singing. Another like testament to the voice the actors. Vocal,
yeah. The vocal
talent. Okay, so they actually see. I'm picturing these, but I can't remember what they sound like at all.
So it's a mix of stuff. It's called Sing the Blues, and there are a couple, like, they're singing like blues standards, you know, like Homer singing Born Under a Bad Sign or whatever. But it opens up with there's like a couple, like there's two Bart songs, including Do the Bart Man, which are more like hip hop inspired.
Which I do remember that, yes.
And apparently that was like it was kind of denied at the time, but apparently that was like co-written and produced by Michael Jackson. I just love thinking about the early 90s, like Michael Jackson was like, you know, like working on Sonic and like The Simpsons or whatever, but like low key, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know what the deal with that was. But
I mean, there's something kind of, I don't know, because that was always, even in I guess he shows up in season 3 of The Simpsons, yeah. And he goes uncredited.
like he's doing it for the love of the game, you know?
The love of the game.
But so you've got that. You've got, there's a couple Lisa like ballads. Like there's one, she's doing a blues song, you know, sax solo, but then there's one that's like a slow ballad, and it's like Yeardley Smith, she does a really good job. Yes. Like singing. Yes. Like I think she's a really good singer, and like the one that's like mm-hmm. that sad ballad I think was kind of touching. I was getting emotional listening to it, because again my dad had it and I would sneak it, and it was a great CD. Like it had really good art, and it had a great booklet and everything. It was like really and really well produced. And so I was listening to this and feeling nostalgic. And then like some of the serious songs were like kind of hitting me. But then you've got like there's a Mr. Burns one, which is more of a hip hop one, and it's like look at all these idiots. And that's one where it's like, I don't know if it's because of the voice or whatever, but Harry Shearer is like not singing. He's like sing talking as Mr. Burns, you know what I mean? But he's giving the performance his all, and it's really good, I think.
Okay. Fascinating.
I would recommend listening to it.
Yeah.
Do which, the Bartman and Nancy Cartwright, does she raps as Bart, you know? Gotta give her props, you know.
Which I mean, I guess now that I'm thinking about it. There are some really good songs in later seasons of The Simpsons. I don't think season 2 has any big musical numbers, right? No. They do go on to write some really funny, like original songs.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So okay, I'm gonna have to put this on. I'm gonna revoke my Simpsons fan card if I don't listen to this.
That's how I learned what things were. There's a Bart has a rap where he's like in trouble because he put mothballs in stew or something, and that's how I didn't know what mothballs were at the time, you know. So I was like, what the hell? But yeah, it's really good. It's good stuff. There's a Homer and Marge like love duet. It's very sweet. The Marge. Like, again, I don't know what her actually singing voice is like, but that's one where, like, Marge is, like, not a good singer, necessarily. Like, it sounds good in the song, but, she's, like, you know what I mean? And it's very... Yeah,
the Marge
voice. It's a very endearing performance, and their duet is very sweet, very cute. I think you would get a little emotional listening to this album, Vic.
Okay. I mean, I would be the first to admit that I have cried at many episodes of The Simpsons. I cried earlier today watching Lisa's Substitute. Okay. I'm going to have to put this on.
Bart! Go to bed!
Sure thing, Dad!
It's Bart versus the Space Mutants for your NES.
Rumba!
Only Bart Simpson can save the Earth.
Bart! Okay,
Get The Simpsons game for your NES from Acclaim.
Bart!
So just to bring it full circle real quick, before we go back to video games, there are Simpsons video games.
Yes, there are.
I think, as we go through time in our show, we're going to talk about more. So I just want to real quick talk about the ones from like that came out while these seasons were airing. Less noteworthy, Bart versus the Space Mutants on NES. I played it back in the day, didn't really remember it. Loaded up on an emulator on my N64. I have an NES emulator on my N64. I played a little bit. I thought it sucked or whatever. So don't have much to say about that. But let's just talk about the Konami arcade game, The Simpsons. I'm sure, Vic...
One of the best.
Yeah. Konami already... Like, they're known for their arcade beat-em-ups. They're known for a lot of things. But, like, they were... at this time period making some awesome ones like the Ninja Turtles one, but the Simpsons one is really sweet, and I think it's cool because it's made so early that they don't even have a lot to go off of, and it still feels very like it feels like The Simpsons. You know what I mean? It doesn't feel like, oh, that's weird. They haven't figured it out yet. What did you like, McKenna? We went and we played through it over the weekend the arcade. What did you think?
It was fun.
Yeah.
You can have four people playing.
Hell yeah.
The four. Maya minus Maggie, who was kidnapped.
Well, you gotta save
that's
Maggie.
That's why you're playing. That's what your mission, to save Maggie. But I mostly played as Bart, and I thought running around or skating around on his skateboard was fun, and using it to whack people.
Very cool. Yeah. Like, the characters mostly play the same, but they just have like Lisa with the jump rope, or Marge with the vacuum. Like, they kind of all have like their own unique like look and animations and stuff, and it's just very fun to like go smash around as them. Vic, what is your memory of the game?
I love this game. I think the one big thing that a lot of people point to is that it doesn't necessarily have like the most perfect continuity. Hey, there's like weird colored Smithers, and there's a couple of things that don't quite like link up with the show exactly, but it is so fun. And anytime we're at an arcade, if I'm with anybody at an arcade and the Simpsons game is on, we at least got to play through the first couple levels. It's legitimately like, I think, such a good beat 'em up. There was a very short period of time where it was available on like the PlayStation Network. And I was really excited to download it on like PlayStation 3 at the time, but it's since been delisted. I think they like have re-released it as like one of those one-up arcade cabinets, or whatever those arcade cabinets you can buy at like Walmart now. It's genuinely, and I guess this probably speaks more on how many terrible Simpsons games there are, but it's genuinely one of the best Simpsons games. It's like, it's got to be in the top three Simpsons games, probably. It's so fun.
Yeah, you're right. Like, there's a bunch, even comparing it to, it, like, it's contemporary. And I guess, like, comparing an arcade game to an NES game is a little bit hard to do. But, like, you know, I'm sorry to acclaim, but I just, Bart versus the Space Mutants did not move the needle. But one thing I loved about this arcade game, actually, was, like, kind of the framing thing of all the levels was they had the life and hell rabbits. I thought that was actually pretty cool. It's like that's true. It gives us sort of this like I don't even know how to describe it. It's like sort of this meta element to it, where they're sort of like the, like I said, the framing device of the game, or like each level they're kind of introducing the levels, you know. Very cool. And There's a famous Easter egg in that, of when Marge gets electrocuted, and you know, you see the skeleton. She's got the ears.
Yep.
That's pretty classic all time Easter egg for sure. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you're right. You are just beating up like random guys and stuff. Like, there's Krusty the Clown stuff. Like, yeah, maybe there would be more characters you could do in it now. But I think overall, it's still, and like you said, Smithers is different, but I think overall it still feels very Simpsons, and you're going to a lot of like locations from the show and stuff that are memorable, power plant and things like that, and it's got the fun dream level and I think it holds up very well, like probably better than most Simpsons games. There are some good ones that we'll talk about down the line, but yeah, I think it holds up pretty good.
I agree 1,000%. And again, maybe that's more to do with how many terrible games there are. But even with like the little inconsistencies, it's still one of the best. It's like, it's so fun. I don't think a Simpsons beat 'em up game has any right to be as good as that game is. If you went to the same arcade that you took me to.
Oh, yes, it was. The Underground Retrocade.
Yes. There was, when we went, a Simpsons bowling game. And that's going to be I think, right on your, going to be right on the end of the spectrum of your time frame, but I do think that is an underappreciated Simpsons game. It's so fun. They got all the voice acting. I just need to shout it out ball. Because it's got the trackball. Yeah, the golden tee, like bowling, golfing. I don't think enough people know about the Simpsons bowling arcade game, and I just needed to shout it out.
It also has, I guess we're doing that. I don't know. I don't remember if they had Ninja Turtles there, but it does have that X-Men beat 'em up game that Konami also did. That's two screens. Do you remember that game?
Yeah.
Two screens, and there you can play as, like, I don't know, is it like six characters or something at once? Pretty sick. Konami was like on top of it at that
time. On fire. The beat 'em up. Yeah. Yes.
But I was thinking, with like kind of the resurgence of those sort of beat 'em up games, like you've got a, like the new Streets of Rage game, and there's that new Ninja Turtles game. Maybe we could, maybe, come on, can we get a new Simpsons beat 'em up with some online play? Maybe we could play together, you know?
I would pay premium $70 video game prices for this.
Hell yeah.
Because I don't know that there has been, I'm trying to think of the most recent Simpsons game. There was a game when I was in college, The Simpsons Tapped Out, on like it was on the mobile iOS devices. That was very, very addictive. But I don't think there's been a Simpsons video game in a long time.
Now you just like put them in Fortnite or something, you know what I mean?
Sure.
They should make like a fighting game. I don't know, like, come on, if they haven't done that already.
Notoriously, they did make a Simpsons wrestling game that is very, very bad. It's like god awful.
Okay. I'm just thinking, now we live in the age of there's all those, there's like the Nickelodeon one, there's the multiverses. Like, let's get that ripoff Simpsons.
You're saying a game. Smash clone. I mean, again, there's enough characters. You could absolutely put Dr. Nick Riviera against Lionel Hutz. Give me Dr. Hibbert versus Sideshow Mel. Please, I would play the hell out of that game.
I think this has been a really good retrospective of the first two seasons. Like, I feel like we've covered a lot. Is there anything else we kind of you wanted to add? Or I mean, I can't think of it. Short of like naming every episode.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Vic, any other final thoughts on the early years of The Simpsons?
Well, so I was just going to ask, Gu, I know that you're going to continue to watch. McKenna, did watching these first two seasons inspire you to watch more? Or are you kind of thinking like, you know what, I'm good?
Yeah, I'd like to watch more.
We're for sure gonna. Yeah.
Okay. Well, please let me know when you watch some more, and I would love to join you all to talk about the actual like great, timeless, some of the best episodes of television of all time. I would love to talk to you about those too.
I'm thinking, I don't know. I was actually looking at the Simpsons history on Wikipedia, and it almost seems delineated like different people are in charge, like pretty much every two seasons. And so I'm thinking two seasons is like a good episode. Amount. So I don't know if you want to come back in the future for 3 and 4.
I would love to. It's usually like every 2 to 3 seasons until it gets to the season 13 or 14. Then it's like one guy for 10 years in a row. But yeah, the decade that you're focusing on, it's every couple of years. Every couple of seasons, there's some new showrunners. Let's do it. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Maybe one or two times a year or something. We're going to be doing this. It's going to take us like over a decade to go through the N64 library. Who knows what the world is even going to be like, but yeah, maybe a couple times a year, get together, talk Simpsons. It's absolutely like a great blast from the past just to hang out and pod with you.
I am honored that you thought of me. I hope that you beat Quest 64 and then you call me back and we talk about seasons 3 and 4.
Awesome.
Have you already done Quest 64?
We have not.
That's what I thought.
Actually, I'm gonna have to get a list from you of N64 games too, like that you would want to talk about. We have to get you on the proper main series of episodes. So
Quest 64 is I don't think it's stood the test of time very well, but it has a very soft spot in my heart. So snowboard kids, I feel like snowboarding was really popular in the 90s. I loved 1080 snowboarding.
Yeah.
I loved not a Nintendo 64, but I love the SSX tricky games.
Oh yeah.
A lot of snowboarding in the 90s for some reason.
1080 Avalanche, if you're getting onto the GameCube. I was just playing some of that.
Yep.
Well, okay, cool. Is there anything you want to promote? Anything you want to put out there?
Nope. I'm just happy to talk with you all. So maybe next time I'll have something. But thanks for having me on. I appreciate it, y'all.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, cool. Thanks everyone for listening. Check out all our stuff down below. And we'll see you later.
Bye.
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 As always, we want to give a special shout out to our Millennium Star tier patrons over on Patreon. We've got Underline V, Paul, Nico Sylvian, Kiefer, Jeremy Aber, Infection Form, and joining us now on Waluigi's Island, we have Darren Hupke, our good pal. So thank you all so much. We appreciate it. For anyone else who's curious, you can find us on Patreon over at patreon.com/flashback64.